All right, it's time to start. Welcome to this talk about IPFS and how to distribute the web. So, I don't know, have you heard about IPFS before? Quite a few people. Okay, I'm not an expert, I just like this topic a lot, so I learned a bit about it, so I'm going to like do an introduction. If you know more than me, you can, you know, chime in and tell me some stuff that you also know about. I think it's a really cool thing, so that's why I'm talking about it. It's kind of in early stages, so it's maybe not possible to use it for production yet, but maybe it is, I don't know. You have to try yourself. So who am I? I'm Fredrik. I've been working with development for 20 years or something like that, so I'm becoming one of these old guys in the industry. So just, that's also an interesting thing. How many, is there anyone that's older than me? How old am I? 46. Anyone older than 46 here? No one. I'm the oldest person in this room. Okay, so when you talk about diversity, you know, more women in the field, but maybe also more old people in the field. It's not so common that I work with, actually, people that are older than me that also is doing development. And I think that's a bit of a shame. So I hope you continue development for a long time. Are you Java developers? Java, yeah. No, someone that's not doing Java, like JavaScript or something. No, obviously, Java conference, right? So I've been doing mostly Java back in the days. I was doing only Java, but the last couple of years I've been doing some Go, actually, and IPFS is mostly written in Go. Also Ruby and some other languages. So I find it really rewarding to try out new languages and go around a bit and discover things. So today is actually Midsummer's Eve, and in Sweden, where I come from, this is what we do. Silly dancing around the pole and having strawberries and also drinking a lot, but that's not in the pictures because not correct, you know. So I'm here instead because it's more fun, obviously, to talk about IPFS than being at home celebrating Midsummer. I work for this company, Goosey Talents. We are in Stockholm, and we are obviously recruiting, so if you are interested in moving to Stockholm and the development, you can come and talk to me afterwards. So this is like an agenda. I will do a quick overview first, and then I will move into an opportunity space about how this with IPFS could be a better thing for the internet. Then I will talk a bit about how it works. I will show some things on the command line. And then I will try to code a bit using Java to store objects in IPFS. We'll see how that goes. And lastly, a couple of use cases. So this talk will be a bit about the technology, but also about what's the usage for this. What's the point of doing something like this on the internet today? So it's sort of a bit political message maybe, but I think you will probably agree with me, all of you, so we will see. So I'm a bit sad, and that is because the internet was used to be a nicer place than it is now. It was kind of an open thing. Anyone could put up a web page anywhere. And of course, we can still do that, but content has been centralized enormously. You go to Twitter, Medium maybe for blogging, Facebook, there are a couple of big players that control basically the content on the internet today. I think that's a bit of a shame. And I think we as developers, we should try to find a way to do something about it. And IPFS might be a thing for that. And we might be less sad in the future. Who knows? So what is it? It stands for Interplanetary File System. Okay, this is like science fiction or something. One might think that IP is Intel protocol, but it's interplanetary. And the name says a lot about the ambition behind this project. The idea is to be able to have a file system that works over planets, so it should be really distributed, right? So it could work. We can have some files here, we move it to some other place in the universe, and it should still work. So this design is for this use case. So what does IPFS say about itself? This is like the sales pitch on the site. So they actually stopped using the word interplanetary on the site. I think they maybe thought it was a bit silly or something they came up with when they were drinking and decided to do this, I don't know. But this is what it says. IPFS is the distributed web, a peer-to-peer hypermedia protocol to make the web faster, safer, and more open. So the thing to look at mostly here is that it's supposed to be hypermedia protocol, and what does that mean? It means that it's meant to be a replacement for HTTP. And that's a pretty huge, you know, thing to try to achieve. And I think there's been other efforts to replace HTTP before, but this is supposed to be able to live besides HTTP. So we'll see a bit how that works in practice later on. If you go on to Wikipedia, it might be more like objective description, I don't know. It says that IPFS is a protocol, an eponymous network designed to create the content addressable peer-to-peer method of storing and sharing hypermedia in a distributed file system. So if you think about it, HTTP and the web is really also a big file system. The difference here is that IPFS is peer-to-peer, so it's spread out all over the internet on all the nodes that are running it at the same time. Also another thing, content addressable, that the content you have on IPFS, if you have a name to something, it will always be the same content behind it. So we'll see more about how that works also later on. So this technology is built on the shoulder of giants. I think this was a fun picture. So it's basically torrents. So if you've been downloading stuff from the internet, like movies, I think, you probably used BitTorrents, and it's the same technology behind this thing. It's actually its own protocol, but it's very similar to BitTorrents. Also, Git is a thing that it's based on, the possibility to have directory structures that have a unique identity with a hash. It's used in IPFS. Cryptography, of course, to make sure that things are the right ones. And finally, distributed hash tables, and that is used to look up things on different nodes, different pieces of a file where they exist. So that was a short introduction about IPFS. So now I want to talk about a few opportunities this technology have. So I will talk about three of them, and the first one is the opportunity to move it from a centralized to a decentralized internet. So now with HTTP, I guess when the internet came around, it was sort of a decentralized effort, right? That the military of the US wanted it to be spread out, the data kind of thing. But when you think of it now, it's more like content, a server, a name, it's in one place. And one person is, or company is controlling it. So there's an opportunity to move away from this and go to a peer-to-peer thing. So features of centralization is that control is in one place, one company, one person controls it. We also need to trust this entity. We need to trust Facebook to treat our data correctly, to keep it up there as long as we want. Another thing with centralization is that it's a single point of failure. I don't remember if you... I don't know if you remember, if Bitbucket went down, like in February or something, this Git storage thing. Where I worked at that point, it meant that we couldn't deploy in production. So that was kind of a bit sad, because Git is a distributed thing, right? So it should work anyway. So this is one thing that's bad with centralization, I would say. And also, centralization means inefficient performance. If I go to a site and get some data, and you also do it, we will sort of use the same thing, the same network, twice to get the same content. That's a bit unnecessary. If we get the same content, we should be able to get it from somewhere that's close by, so we can reuse our bandwidth in some way. So basically, you can say that HTTP is a bit like this. So you have to know where the data is, while IPFS is more like you don't have to care about where the data is. It's somewhere out there, you have a name for it, and you can go and get it. It might be in one of these clouds, or it might be in all of them spread out a bit. It doesn't matter. So you can think of it as a cloud like this, where you have, like, suppose you're going to get some content from the left side and you're on the right side. Okay, that's going to take some time because it's a huge network. But once you have done it, then some other person that wants to get the same content will have it readily available in the nodes that are close by in the network. So it's a good thing for performance. Okay, so opportunity two. The problem with the web today is that the content moves around. It's not possible to trust that the content that you were getting like yesterday, that it's still there today. It would be nice to have a way to ensure that the content will be there always. And that's what IPFS tries to solve with something called the permanent web. So what about content? It changes. It can be another content tomorrow than it is today. It might be rerouted, it might be somewhere else. I don't know if you move the blog sometimes and you want to, you know, keep the links the same as they were before. It can be a bit hard. You have to do some effort to make sure that the content is where it is supposed to be. Welcome. Also, content disappears. It goes away. It's not there anymore. So how long will the content be there? With HTTP, we cannot really know. No one can know for sure how long it will be there. But with IPFS, it may be there forever. It's not necessarily so, because someone still needs to back up the content somewhere. Otherwise, it will be garbage collected away. But it might be forever. If someone is interested in the content, it will always be there. And then another problem, can we trust the content? When you go to Wikipedia sometimes and they refer to sites on the internet, it's just like fetched on this date. So then they like have the back free if someone is going to say that this is the wrong link or something. Because at this point in time, it was actually the right content. But with IPFS, if you have a name to something, that name will always point to the same content. And that's a really good thing. Okay, and this one I added the other day because I don't know if you heard about this law in the EU that happened the other day. There were some regulations about freedom on the internet that were passed. So I thought maybe this was a thing to talk about also. So an opportunity is to give more freedom to people, basically. It's very easy to censor HTTP. It's just, you know, set up some firewalls and stuff, the Great Wall of China, whatever, and then you can remove content easily for the people in that country. If you have a more decentralized approach, it's much harder to do this, and the people can decide for themselves if they want to access a certain content or not. Even like in Spain, they were sort of blocking things when Catalonia wanted to be free. They were blocking the sites they used to communicate. And Spain is supposed to be like a democracy. So they actually used IPFS to get to the content in that case. So it's useful in these cases. So I think the corporate web, like the big companies, they actually benefit from regulations. And it's because it's good for business, and it's hard to live up to regulations, so small businesses can't do it. You have to be a bit bigger. You have to have a huge department of lawyers to be able to apply for all the regulations. This image is actually from Normandy. It's a barbed wire that was supposed to kept like the Allies out of France in the Second World War. I don't know if that's a good image or so, but sort of the free world is want to get in, and we put up some wire. So the laws that were passed on, I think it was on Tuesday, or maybe Wednesday, Article 11, so this is a tax on links. So if you link to a newspaper, you're supposed to pay money to the newspaper. And that's really strange, I think. There's nothing that should happen on the internet. I think it should maybe be the other way around, though, that if you link to newspaper, maybe you should get paid, you know? So I'm not sure. I don't think this will work in practice. We will see. Another thing is a content filter. And that's like copyright thing. You know, YouTube, they are removing copyrighted content like music. All the stuff that are copyrighted, so we can't publish things that are under copyright. Now they passed a law in Europe that everyone needs to do this. So this essentially means that a small site cannot let its user publish anything, I would say, because they might then break the law. We will see how this turns out in practice, but it's a very sad thing, I think, for the internet to have this kind of things happening. So let's try to democratize instead. When you think about it, content is one thing. I mean, that's just data, basically, like text, music, whatever. But what it's really behind it is a culture, the culture that all of us humans sort of create together. And content can, of course, be regulated, but culture cannot be regulated. That's the sum of all of us, the thing we want to have. So the question here, I think, is do we really want the culture of property holders who sort of forbid other people to do things, or do we rather want the culture of sharing? So that's one thing to think about. So that's the third opportunity about getting more freedom on the internet, and IPFS might be a tool for this, might be other ones also. I will talk a bit more about this also in the broader context later. So, how does it work? So if you run a node, something like this happens, three ports are opened up. One is for the swarm, like for nodes to connect to each other, one is for the API to access it, and one is a gateway for publishing content. So I have a node up and running somewhere here. Maybe we can start it again. It seems to be a bit sad. So it's easy to run a node. This is actually a full-blown node. You just install your IPFS and run it. So this one is implemented in Go, and that's like the main implementation of the standard. But there's also an implementation in JavaScript, actually. So you can run an IPFS node in the browser. And that's pretty weird, I think, but very useful. So then your JavaScript applications can actually publish and get the content from IPFS. So here we see that it started to announce stuff on the Swarm 4001. Oh, it's a bit outside there. And then it sets up an API server on 5001 and also the gateway. So I will just show a few things that you can do on the command line. So there's basically this thing has an API now. At this port 5001 that we can talk to. So most clients, there's one command line client that I will show now, but there are also other ones in all languages you can think about. So let's try to add something to IPFS. That could be cool, right? So we could add what? DevOx. So what I do here is I actually just echo DevOx a string into the IPFS add command, and I tell it to be quiet because I only want the hash back. That's the ID. And I put this in a hash variable. So this is, at this point, you can actually add whatever you want. You can add a file. You can add like a directory structure with stuff in it. Or you can add just string, or you can add like binary. IPFS doesn't care, just put whatever you want in there. So if we have a look at this one. So this is like an identity in IPFS. They always look like this. And this one is then always going to point to the content, the string, DevOx, and nothing else. So now we can use this to access it. And we had the gateway open on 8080. So if I call it, it's available there. So what I normally try at this point, which never works, but in a good world, this would work also. There's a public gateway over here. But it just takes forever, so it won't happen. But the idea is that this content now is available like everywhere on the node, and it will eventually return here, but it takes some time. And this is like, since it's new technology, it's not always very fast. But once it has gotten to this point, it will be there. So then it will be fast. So I tried this with images also, and also takes a while. But after a while, it gets there. And once it is there, it will be there for a while. And how long, you might ask then. It depends. If it's not used, it will be removed. Someone needs to back up the content, pin it to a node. Otherwise, it will disappear sooner or later. As long as people are interested in the content, also, it will be there in node serving it. So. Okay, we can just try to change this. Also, could be fun. So DevOx is great. And now the hash is completely different. Okay, that was just a quick look at the command line API. Also, we can do stuff like this. You see, I was using curl to get it, but obviously, you can use the command line also. It's just the same thing. There you go. DevOx is great. Yay. We also get a little web interface here that is running on local, I don't know if you see, localhost 5001. In the API thing, there is also a web server you can use to look for stuff. And also this little globe you can look. So I'm now connected to 178 other nodes. That's pretty cool, right? They're all over the world there. So. Pretty sweet. Here can also see I'm running a small plugin for Firefox that can understand IPFS links. You can see it now, but it's up in the corner, and it also keeps track of the number of nodes. And there you can, if you have an IPFS link, the browser will just understand it and show it in the browser. Otherwise, I mean, browsers don't know about IPFS yet. Firefox is actually working on native support for IPFS, but I will be surprised if Chrome or some other, you know, vendors are doing it, not at this point at least. Cool, so basically it's a distributed file system. So it works like this. I mean, when you get stuff from HTTP, it goes through a number of nodes on the way, often like 20 or something. IPFS also, I mean, lots of nodes, obviously, but they can be done in parallel. So when you think about like large files, for example, you can understand that this is way more performant than HTTP. So that's a use case that people are already using today. For example, you want to move, say, Docker containers between data centers. That's like an interesting use case for IPFS. You just put them out there, you get an ID, and you can use the ID to retrieve it from anywhere. So there are some interesting, there are lots of use cases when you dig into it. First you think it's just about, you know, serving content on the web, but many other things you can do with it. So things we do here is routing with distributed hash tables. It's basically how to find the data in all the nodes. If you have bigger files, they will be divided into blocks, and every block has an ID. And you can find these blocks with a distributed hash table. Then we block exchange with the BitSwap protocol, and the BitSwap protocol is like a new thing for IPFS. I think that's the only unique thing in IPFS, really. But it's sort of BitTorrents, basically. So the same idea, but they changed a bit. I don't know about the details. I'm not too good at these things. And then you have object trees with the Merkle dog, so you can have like versioning and trees of files and stuff like that. But the coolest thing, one of the cool things is the unique names. So this name will always point to the same data, no matter what happens. So that's a really nice thing. So once you have reference to it, you will know that this is there forever. So then, I mean, this is like immutable content, right? So you cannot change it. That's the thing we like nowadays in programming. It wasn't used to be like this, but now it's immutable. It's good. But then, if you want to change it, what are you going to do? I guess you've been starting to think about this already. If you just have, you know, things that point to the same thing, if you want to update your website, for example, what are you going to do then? So when I started looking at the IPFS, they didn't have anything about this, but now they've come up with this thing, IPNS. It's like a distributed name service. So here you also have a hash, but it's only based in the routing system of IPFS. And you can actually point it to other things. You can change it to point to some new thing if you want to. I was trying to use this like the other day and come up with like a demo, but it didn't work. So it's very immature, I think, this thing. Or maybe I'm not good enough at it. I don't know. But it was very hard to get anything working. But it seems like a pretty cool thing. And another thing you can do here is also to put in your DNS record, which obviously is a centralized thing. It's not so good. But you can put the DNS record, the TXT record, that IPFS or IPNS rather understands. So when you have a name, when you have your own domain name, you can put this IPNS hash in there. So you can actually have readable links that's useful, that points to IPFS content. So this is not the long-term solution, because obviously we want to get rid of DNS. It's not a good thing. It's a centralized thing, you know. Implementations, as I said, servers in Go and JavaScript, and clients, I think, in all the languages. If you're Java devs, there's a nice Java client I will show in just a short while. Now, actually, this is Mikael Åkergren. He's guitarist and lead singer of the great Swedish metal band Opeth. I'm sure you heard about them. No. Okay, but we're going to do live coding now, so that's why. Oh, sorry. So I will just do a very simple example with storing objects in IPFS with Java. So one use case that's interesting is with blockchains, you know, you have limited storage. If you want to store something on Ethereum or Bitcoin, it can cost you some. So a good thing is to actually store a reference to something. And this reference, it's really nice if it's going to be there like forever. So IPFS is a good choice. So in this example, I just came up with the contract kind of thing. So that's one thing you can do with blockchains, I guess. Store a contract in them, and then can just be a reference to this thing. So this contract just have a text and signatories. It's a very simple thing. It's not don't use this for real stuff. Okay. So I was thinking we could actually test drive this, because TDD is fun, right? And since there are so many, mob programming, have you tried that? No? Anyone doing mob programming? Now it's a huge mob, so you can help me if I do any mistakes, right? It's good. Should save document. We can do something like this. Okay, so I actually prepared like a TV chef contract storage. Okay, let's save a contract there. And we need the contract, obviously. I have decided we agree is a good text on a contract. So it's me. Signatories, maybe it's you also, and some other people. So we have a contract, we want to save it, and maybe just want to get something back. We want to get back an ID, I think. So we have saved it, we have an ID, we want to assert that it's in there. So I made this before the assert method here that actually gets something from IPFS and looks at it, that it has some content. Something like this, and we did an exception. So will this work? Probably not, because we haven't coded it yet. Yes. So I made a small little interface here, storage, so it can save and load things. It's very simple. I mean, you can save and load anything from IPFS. Let's implement them. Okay, what were we doing? Saving, right? Then we can use the add. Streamable storage might be a good name. Okay, so what is this? A named streamable. Good name, right? Named streamable. So this can be of different kinds. There's a binary wrapper, there's a div wrapper, and a file wrapper. Basically, things you might want to save, actually. But we want to save a byte array this time. And we need some bytes in there. So let's get some bytes from the storage then. Oh, good. Bad name. No one is complaining. I thought I would get some help from you, but apparently not. So we have the contract, and I did some JSON thing here. There we go. Maybe there is an exception also surround. Okay, somewhat better. Let's do something here also. Through, what's your favorite don't know what to do exception kind of thing? Illegal state? Runtime? Throwable? No? Okay, how many is up for illegal state? Okay, that's like half maybe? Okay, we won. Cool. It's like it means nothing, right? It's perfect. Okay. Do you think this will work? There's some red thing in here. What's that? Okay, let's try to run it. It will tell us. Missing return. Ah, this is not so good. Missing return statement. No one catched it. So what you get back when you add something is a list of nodes. Because you can add several things. If you have a directory structure, for example, there will be lots of nodes. But we only have one node, so we can be a bit sloppy here and just do like this. Don't do this, I mean, for real. It would be bad. And then we can take the hash and to be. You see, some of this is not like idiomatic Java, like this stuff here, hash kind of thing. You want to have get hash, right? I don't care so much anymore, but the API is a bit rough in that way, I would say. So, do you think it will work? I think 80%. Oh, cool. So I was planning to do a read test also. We have 15 minutes. Maybe we have time for that. Or we can just go to the here and implement it so you can see what it looks like. Up here also, I didn't mention, I just created a static IPFS instance. and that is pointing to my local running IPFS node. So here you can obviously point to whatever you have. If you have some good centralized node somewhere, you can point to that instead. So that's going to work well. So these tests are really not unit tests, it's more like integration tests. So if you're going to read from IPFS, then we do something like this. And there is cat, that is actually for getting data out of it. And then there is also a get thing. And that's more like getting files. It's synchronously added, I would say, at this point. I'm not completely sure, but there's probably opportunities for improvement of the client. I don't think there are any callbacks or anything like that in the API. So I'm not actually completely sure. That's a good question. So we want to have a multi-hash when we're going to cut something. And here we get bytes back, I think. Yes. And then we just want to have a contract. So there you go. So it's very easy to, probably have some exception here also. It's very easy to integrate with. And I mean, if you have worked with a document database, it's maybe very similar, like for Mongo or something like that. So what's the difference here? I would say the main use case for using this in like an application like normal Java thing would be if you have a need to be sure that the content is always the same and you also want it distributed. So consider you have several applications spread out in many locations, then they can access the same content and you don't need to do anything about, you know, moving it around. So that's really an interesting thing, I would say. So for some types of applications, it might make sense to actually use it as like the internal storage. I would say that's probably rare. It's probably much easier to just use a normal database, but it could be an interesting tool to have in mind for some things. Where is the data? Is that a question? That's a good question. Initially, it will be in this node that I have. It will be the whole thing will be there, and I can tell my node to pin it to have it forever. And then when someone retrieves it somewhere else, then it will start to spread out over the network. So it will be a bit here and there. I mean, it's like torrents. It will, if it's like a big file, it will probably be spread out on several nodes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very hard to find, you know, where is the data. And that's, I mean, that's one of the good things, I would say, with this technology. But if you have, maybe for GDPR or something like that, when you want to delete the user's data, maybe it's not so good, I don't know. So... I guess you could. I mean, the hash is just this big, so you could just go over it and get data if you want to, but if you have lots of computer power, I guess. Did you have a question also? When the node is shut down? Sorry, it was... Aha, if I shut down my node there, then the data will be gone if it hasn't been retrieved by someone. So you have to have the nodes up. But that's a good thing also that you have several nodes working together. So as soon as the data is used like in several places, then you will have it spread out a bit. But if you want to be sure that your data is there, you should probably have a couple of nodes up and running and pinning the data that you're interested in on those nodes, I would say. So, any more questions? if I can push it to
other nodes. They can only fetch.
I can, if I have the IP, obviously can go to several nodes if I want to and push it. But this port will probably not be open. The normal is that you have the swarm port open and the gateway maybe.
When you add the data, it's added to your node, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then say you are afraid that your node will be shut down.
Mm-hmm. Yes, good question. I haven't thought about that, but I guess you can have several like IPFS instances up at the same time. It would be one way to do it, and then call all of them. I'm not sure if there is any good, replication thing here. Actually, I don't think so, but that might be other. Otherwise, you can go to those other nodes and just retrieve it from like anywhere, then it will be on that node also. But maybe you want to pin it to that node, then you have to do something else. Then you need to get access to the API, and it must be your node basically. So I guess that could be something to build into like a client like this. I don't think it is now, but to make sure that you pin the content to a couple of nodes. Get the latest data for some entity, something like this. Do you mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see your point. There's this IPNS thing to actually get the latest thing of something. But IPNS is actually like a pointer that you can reset to the latest thing. So it serves this purpose to point to the latest thing. You have to tell it to now this hash points to this other IPFS, immutable hash. Yeah, this is maybe not so practical. So, some use cases it's not really made for. So there's also an activity now to build some kind of pub-sub thing in IPFS. So that can also possibly be used for this purpose, I would say. Okay, cool. Let's go back to the slides. It was more fun with code, right? So we only have like 6 minutes left, so I will go through this a bit quick. A couple of use cases. Wikipedia is actually on IPFS. We can look at it. And you see this link here was actually just this. And my browser understood it with this plugin that it's serving it from my local node now. And it's not very friendly URL, obviously. But if you go to the end, I don't know if you can see, but it ends with /wiki/. And if you move on there, we can go to post impressionist, very hard word. And I haven't got before, so it was retrieved now from the network. So here you actually have a hash, and then you have like a relative content that's included in this hash. So you can have like nice relative paths to the end of your things. So here we could just put in whatever. I think we can try Krakow. Yeah, Krakow. So It's a nice thing, and then Wikipedia can be accessible behind you know, firewalls trying to block it. For example, in Turkey, they had some problems with this. They're blocking Wikipedia. I already talked a bit about blockchain, but this is a really nice use case, I would say, to save references. No, never. The hash is calculated from the content. It can never be anything else. Yeah, blockchain, I talked about that before. Let's move on. So this also is an interesting use case, I think. This is a map of the least developed countries in the world. So it's mostly Africa, a bit of Asia. Max had presented before me about the progressive web. He had actually nicer maps. I was a bit envious about that. But it was about the bandwidth speed in different countries. And then you saw that like everything, Africa, South America, some of Asia, it's very slow, you know, to use the internet there. So we are happy to live in Europe and have fast internet. This is an interesting map also. It shows the most common operative system in this country. So blue is Windows and green is Android. So in Africa, they are mostly using phones to access the internet. And then you can imagine that it might not be that fast, right? And I would like to have Linux here, but obviously not. So these are things that IPFS helps to solve also, to move the content closer to where people are, and then you can get to it faster. Or even if you are on Europa, the moon of Jupiter, maybe in the future, who knows, the interplanetary thing. So, I'm getting to the end there. So is IPFS the future? I don't know. I think there are many technologies coming up that are interesting, solving sort of similar problems. IPFS is one of them. So I think we should, you know, try to make the internet a more happy place in the future. And I strongly believe that it's us developers, we have to do something about this. Because if I talk to my parents or my siblings, they don't care, they just want it to be easy to use. They don't care if Facebook have all the data. They don't think about the consequences for the future. But we understand this. We are developers. We understand these things. We should try to push for technologies that make the internet a better place in the future. So that's, I think it's very important. So I hope you take that with you and think about that in the future when you select technologies. Look for open source, look for, you know, distribution, power to the people, those kind of things. Okay, that's all I had. Thank you so much for coming and listening to me. I don't know if you have any questions now. I can take one maybe or something. I have 1 minute left. Otherwise, come and talk to me afterwards. Thank you so much.